Hello everyone, I'm Pranshu. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar. We will begin this session in a minute's time. I can see a few people joining us, so we'll just let them set themselves up and we can get started. I hope you're all well and keeping safe. All right, so I'll quickly be introducing Walking Tree for anyone joining us for the first time, and then we can get on with the presentation. All right, Sudhir, if we could just move to the next slide, please. Right, so Walking Tree Technologies is a technology-focused company with our core focus on designing and building cross-platform web and mobile applications, perform system integrations, enable digital transformation. We also specialize in data integration, data analytics, migration from legacy to modern systems, cloud migrants, and of course, perform UX design. Now, apart from end-to-end application development, we also provide custom solutions to enterprises for web and mobile and very specific services within the software development cycle like UI, UX design, microservices, DevOps and cloud. Our flexible staff augmentation services also provide clients with on-demand skills and resources to help them meet their organizational and business objectives. Lastly, we also help you to implement certain solutions like objective performance assessment. We are also one of the key partners for implementation of Digit, which is an open source platform for urban governance. We have now on to our speaker for the day, that is Sudhir Babu. Sudhir, yes. So Sudhir has a total of experience of over 11 years and his core strengths lie in the fields of automation, DevOps and analytics. Over to you, Sudhir. I think you can get on with your bit. You'll have to unmute yourself first, Sudhir. Sudhir, I think you are still on mute. All right, sorry. We can hear you now.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Pranshu, for the kind word you spoke about me. Good evening, one and all. The topic that we are going to discuss next 40 minutes is about OpenShift Container Platform. In this OpenShift Container Platform, there are multiple features we can discuss and how to deploy application into container platform by using the OpenShift. And we'll discuss about some other points, how to monitor the application in the OpenShift. And this kind of topics we'll discuss one by one. So coming to the features of OpenShift, there are multiple features it supports like self-service platform, multi-language support, automation, user interface, collaboration with a different customized runtime application and scalability and high availability, like container portability, like multi-security and dynamic storage management. There are, and so on. There are different features that's available in the container platform. It's kind of the main major sister of Kubernetes, I can say. So when you talk about multi-language support, in multi-language support, OpenShift supports different languages like Java, Node.js, PHP, Perl, and Ruby, and also other languages are in databases like MySQL, PostgreSQL, MongoDB databases, and for different front end and back end applications. So it supports OpenShift. It's given like, you know, kind of images or kind of applications. You just select by using the GUI, and we can deploy it directly by using the OpenShift platform. I will show you when I demonstrate in demo. When you come to the automation, now OpenShift provides application lifecycle management features to automatically rebuild and redeploy containers when upstream source or container images or scale in and scale out applications based on the scheduling policy. Depends on that. It's like a kind of a CLI remote management applications and resources. Like we can do these applications with the GUI as well as CLI, command line interfaces. We can create the projects, we can deploy the applications, and we can monitor and we can manage all with the CLI as well. So when it comes to user interfaces, so it supports like, you know, REST API integration with the multiple third-party tools. We can call, we can integrate with the outside like the key clocks or other different applications. We can call and we can deploy with the REST APIs. One more major feature is security level. It will support different multi-level security, like it's like SELinux, role-based access control, and ability to integrate with the external authentication systems by using LDAP or auth integrations. So these, by using this, we can secure the application, we can secure the infrastructure by using the multi-level security. We can, by using the Docker daemon over time, by using Docker daemon over time, this one also we can secure that. So it will allow integration with the existing security tools like Kerberos. This is the default security levels for Red Hat. It is providing system-wide security, imputes scoping of access, more customization possible. And also it will support network isolation with the application level. Like, you know, if you deploy an application in multiple nodes or multiple containers, how to integrate with that, and as well as how to secure the application from one front end to back end, for one microservice to another microservices. This kind of network isolation, it will allow it. That is a major advantage in OpenShift. When you come to the image buildings, then image building deployment, we will use the Docker containers. By using the Docker containers, Docker, we can write the Docker file. We can create a Docker image by using the application, front-end application, back-end application. From third-party tools like Docker Hub, we can deploy the applications. We can build as it will support, and also very secure. It will not allow particular users. It will allow, we have to create a particular user, and we have to give the policies called ADM policies, OC in OpenShift. So it's securely, we can build the images, we can securely store the images. And one more important in OpenShift is we can store all the Docker images in image stream. It is a predefined or a default store, Docker Hub, it is there, that's called image stream registry, we can say. All the images, whatever images we created with a particular application, we can store in image registry. That is maintaining by the Red Hat. It supports Red Hat OpenShift supporting. We don't require any Docker Hub kind of thing. So we can access with the third party tools from outside, but we can store these images in the Red Hat OpenShift. That is a major advantage. When you come to the operation team and development team, it's there are common stacks. We can say there are multiple applications, front end, back end. So we want to deploy these applications into different environment, dev environment, test environment, prod environment. These are these kind of stacks we can build in the cloud environment as well as in the containers environment. For this, we can deploy at a time, and say by using the OpenShift, it will allow. That is a major advantage in different stacks should be deployed into the productions. And dev environment to test environment, we can entire CI/CD setup should be set up with OpenShift. That is a major feature here, we can say. When you come to this complexity of operational point of view, there are major things like networking part, storage part, health part. So when we talk about networking part, all the application deploy into same networks or different networks, we can restrict with the network isolations, and we can allow, deny the particular application, particular resource to the different nodes or different master node infrastructure. By using the network concept, we have a concept called network policy. By using that, we can restrict all the application level or infrastructure level, the part-to-part communication we can do. This is the major feature in networking part. And come to the storage part, there are different types of storage it supports, like from external or internal, cloud storages or SEP storage or on-premises data center storage. We can access and we can create a persistent storage. We can create a volumes and we can access that the particular storage to the particular application to store the logs. These kind of modules, we can say storage components available in this. When you come to the health part, so we can secure, we can monitor the pod level, we can monitor the node level, any type of containers applications, we can check health check of this by using the GUI. So if the pod fails, automatically it scale up, it scale down, or by using the container as a cluster. That is the major feature in this. So we can monitor health of the pod and health of the node. When you come to the Kubernetes components, there are the different major things log aggregation and metrics. So log aggregation is the information and application deployed and OpenShift. We can collected, collected, aggregated, and analyze a centralized location. And OpenShift enable you to collect metrics and runtime information in real-time world applications. Like common interface for more data, moving data from one source to another resource, or storing for the data, we use log aggregation metrics. This is a major feature available in the OpenShift. And also events, when you come to the events, we can communicate or we can take a backup of this. So for high availability or whenever anything failure happen, so we can retrieve the data by using this backups, this kind of features we have available in OpenShift. When you come to the architecture part, there are master node architecture in OpenShift 4. There are three node architecture, three master, three node architecture we can build. In this, we can deploy any applications. We have multiple features, it will support. So in this three-tier architecture, we can access the databases, inbuilt databases, as well as we can access from outside. We can create a Postgres as MySQL databases. We can access that for application point of view, as well as it will support from inbuilt, cluster storage and SEP storage and other storages. So it will integrate to the databases, and we can store the data by using the APIs. We can say from master to node. This is the architecture from source code to we can pull the code and deploy into the a particular application, the particular node. And if any node failures, automatically another node, the pods will be created. The application should be up and running. That is a high availability and available in this. So this is the major part in the architecture level. When you come to this application deployment level, whenever any access from the web console, it will call from API, from CLI to web UI. It will schedule the jobs or schedule the builds accordingly. Whenever it is required, we can restrict the, we can access that by using the web console. This is the major advantage. There are three major components in OpenShift, as same as in Kubernetes. It's like Docker and Kubernetes, and OpenShift deploy different type of lifecycle applications. So when you come to the Docker, we have to be we have to install any physical environment, a cloud environment, whenever it's required for to create that. So when you come to the OpenShift in Red Hat, predefined, like, you know, everything will be created, like, you know, Docker installations and Kubernetes installations, whatever it is required for a Kubernetes setup and OpenShift setup, it will create entire thing. So there are different ways of setup OpenShift, like by using the Ansible, we can deploy masternode application, masternode infrastructure, as well as we can deploy with the Terraform. So up to three, it is creating, we can say, different type of packages available, like atomic kind of thing, so 3.2, 3.4, 3.9, this kind of versions till 3.11. It will support, like, you know, by using the Ansible. So from 4 onwards, like, you know, now latest version is 4.6. So from 4.1, 4.5, 4.6, this kind of versions, it is supporting Terraform. So with this Terraform, there are Red Hat's completely giving a binary package. By using that binary package, we can install the masternode architecture. Maybe it's three node architecture, two node architecture, five node architecture. Depends our requirement. We can change the parameters and we can deploy. We can deploy the infrastructure by using the Terraform. So as of now, we have in working tree, we have deployed three node architecture by using the 4.6. So in three master three node by using the Terraform. So it created a three master three node architecture, and we have deployed a DDO application, and we tested in our environment. It successfully created the containerized, and we have authenticated with a backend database. We have tested that. So this kind of Docker and Kubernetes OpenShift lifecycle for deploying and management of this. So it is inbuilt. It is supporting the major feature in OpenShift. When you come to this, like, you know, masternode, as I told you, same thing. There are different components, like, you know, API, schedulers, controllers, and storage. When you come to the storage part, it is like, you know, for configuration configure files, we use etcd and other features in potentially other features in storage. And controllers, we can say we can client access, or schedulers, we can allocate the jobs to the particular pods, or these kind of features available in the master. And you come to the nodes, there are a queue proxy server, like to communicate from master to node for different purposes, we use queue proxy. So these are the major, same as in Kubernetes level. The major thing is in the OpenShift, we can differentiate like this. So we can access with the GUI, we can access with all the pods, we can access to all the applications, we can route the traffics by using the GUI. Whenever come to the Kubernetes part, we have to control with the ingress controller or like, you know, so this is everything will be taken care. That is a major advantage in OpenShift. So when you come to the OpenShift components, there are different services, like, you know, microservices. We can segregate the application into small pieces, and we can deploy into the containers level, and we can integrate with the those pods, and we can access with, like, a front end and back end applications. And whenever it is required, like, you know, redeployment or rebuild the image within a fraction of minutes, we can rebuild that. That is available in the OpenShift, as same as, like, you know, how we creating the containers in the Kubernetes level or Dockerization level. So same thing, it is available in OpenShift. The major thing is it will support, like, an enterprise level, like it automatically will create and more secure than compared to open source. It's like, that is a major advantage in the OpenShift components. So we can run this, like, we can check with this Docker run command, and like a single process, how it is happening, we can check it with these commands. When you come to the image registry, as I told you, like all the images, how when we deployed any application from front end and back end applications, we will create an image And by using the image, we can access the, we can create the containerization of particular applications or microservices, we can say. So those images should be stored under in particular registry that's called image registry, that predefined inbuilt Docker registry is available in OpenShift. That is a main advantage here. So we can access with the Red Hat satellite, like you know, to like to update the packages or to upgrade the, any versions of the any upgradations. We use this one. So image lifecycle, like if any and if we want to manage with the image should be a rebuild, or we can rebuild that, we can test environment, we can promote the dev environment from dev environment to the production environment, we can rebuild that images by using the image lifecycle. Network and routing part, this is very important. Like whenever we are accessing, we are deployed any application, we need to provide some secure routing to the outside. So that is also, it is taken care by OpenShift. Whenever any deployment we done, so it will provide the routing. So it will ask like, you know, which port should be accessed. So in init container or inside container port. So how to access with outside, everything will be, we have to maintain, manage in the, we have to provide the parameters. And as per that, we can deploy, we can access that application outside. So this is the like, you know, different level of protocols it will access, like HTTP, TLS, and SMS. And we can manage with the Nginx and HAProxy and Apache. This is, when you come to the storage level, as this is the same thing, like different storages from external or internal, we can create and we can secure with the SC Linux policies or inside security level. And we can share the file system to the particular, if I have multiple microservices, I want to access the applications into a particular single storage, we can share the file system and we can access with that. This is a major advantage in storage level. So we can integrate with this OpenStack with a different environment, like virtualization, VM environment, and cloud environment, as well as we can deploy in the OpenStack public private cloud. We can build the public private cloud, and we can create an infrastructure, and we can set up this all by using the OpenStack components, and we can access that. And also, it will support Microsoft Azure, as well as Microsoft AWS cloud environment, and GCP, and other cloud platforms it will support. We can deploy this OpenShift and container environment, and we can access outside. So when you come to the deployment level, so there are different levels of deployments we have. So we can deploy the application by using the source code management, or we can use by using the Docker file, or by using the Docker Hub. On different levels, I will demonstrate that. I will show that. So when we have a demo, when I show the demo, you will be comfortable on that. So this is the deployments. Like, you know, there is a single image deployment, or multiple ways we can deploy by using that Docker images or Docker source code management. It will allow source code to. Whenever build the image, build the application, it will pull the code from source code management, and it will create, it's nothing but a source to image. And whenever it build the image, and we can push the artifacts, or we can push the images into a Docker registry, or we can set up that CI/CD pipeline, and we can access with that images or artifacts for whenever it is required, like, you know, dev environment, test environment. We can create the Docker images, we can create the artifacts, and pushing into artifacts and source code management to image registry, we can push that one. This is like we can create a CI/CD pipeline with a Jelkin. Same way we can set up in the OpenShift, it is supporting like so simple image, the Jenkins image will be by using a Jenkins image, we like we can create a Jenkins and we can build and we can test and we can deploy into multiple environment. This is the building the image and deploying into different environment. This is the more like a features. When you come to the application deployment, I will demonstrate now, like, you know, DDO application. So how to deploy this application into OpenShift and how we are used. So we have set up it in the 4.6. So now I'm showing you this in the playground. So in the that is providing by Red Hat. Red Hat is providing this playground. So in that playground, we will deploy and we'll see how the deployment happening and how what is the functionality, we'll see. So the main agent of this application is like, you know, the front end application, I will pull the code from source code management and I will, by using the Docker file, so I will create a image, I will deploy into the containers and I will access from outside. So one single single page, like, you know, single providing like information, it will create everything, like create the image, deploy the containers and access from outside, providing the routes, everything will be created. Let us see. This is the Red Hat playground. I'm using 4.6. This is the terminal, we can access from terminal as well as from GUI. So there are admin level access, developer level access. We can create the users and we can create a, provide a particular policies to the particular developer to access the application, to restrict the infrastructure, everything we can do. So now I'm logging to the admin, just I'm copying. Username admin, password admin. We have here.
Sudhir, we are only able to see the browser right now.
Are you able to see my this playground window? No.
We are still on the browser, actually. Yeah. Yes, we can see it now. Oh, no, we are on the Red Hat page.
So, this, yeah, thank you. So this is the playground of Red Hat OpenShift 4.6. So we can test it application or we can deploy the application, or we can build the applications, or we can create images. So all we can, the Red Hat is providing the online playground for this. So for this, we have to be subscribed this first, then only we'll get the access. So this is my console window. When I click here, it will redirect the console. So it will show you here. So how many projects are available? These are the default projects, as I told you in the slides. So all the like resources, the APIs or authentication operators, these are the different purpose of creating this. Everything is creating. Whenever we created an OpenShift environment, so all the, like, you know, it is taken care by DNS part, like, you know, lifecycle management or infrastructure level, everything is creating. So now I'll create a new project. So for example, this is walking tree. I'll give name walking tree. Sorry, it's taking time. Maybe the network issue. It is creating now. So walking tree project was created. It's kind of namespace. It's like, you know, all the resources, whatever we want to create, like, you know, creating an image, creating a application, or creating any resources under, we can do with that, this namespace or this project. So now I will deploy as per this. Now I will deploy application, DDO application. This is our DDO application, UA application. I'll pull the code from source code management by using the Docker file. We have written a Docker file. So by using the Docker file, we can deploy and we can check that application is working or not. So for this, I'll go to the developers. Now I'm giving the access of, I'm adding the, okay, got it. So now, so these are the features available. So how to deploy for application. From source code management, we can deploy, or we have a container, Docker container or a Docker image we have in third party tool, like the Docker Hub. We can pull the image and provide the details, and we can deploy the application, or we can create a Docker file and provide the details, and we can create a, we can deploy the application. Or by using the YAML file, we can write the YAML file and provide the details with the YAML or JSON format we can deploy. These are the catalog. Catalog is nothing but like there are availabilities of any particular resources like Helm charts or templates, any resources. So we can use the templates, and by using this template, we can deploy the application, or like a middleware application, database application. I want to deploy a MySQL database. I want to deploy a PostgreSQL database or MongoDB database. So we can deploy with, we can select the image, and we can, by using that, we can deploy. Now I'll start with Docker file. So we can select this by using the Helm chart or operator backend or database. Whichever it is comfortable, we can do. Now I will deploy with this Docker file. So now I'm selecting the Docker file, and I will provide the URL of my GitHub. So now I will clone this. And I will provide the URL. So, and I need to provide the credential. See, I want to launch this with the OpenShift branch. There are different branches, and I'll create a credentials secret. So I will give you my name. And there are two ways of authentication. One is SSH authentication. Another one is HTTP authentication. I'm going for basic authentication. So I'm providing my credentials. So for to access the application, I'm using 8080 port. Whatever port we want to give, we can provide here. And I will give here UI front-end application. The application name I'm providing here. And there are different ways of deployment. So deployment, configure deployment. I'm choosing the deployment. I'm just here we can route this. This is the route application. Like, you know, we no need to route again after creating the application. Once you select this, this is the advanced option in application deployment. If not provided, we need to again create the route to access the application outside. So now I'm just selecting this and creating for demo purpose. So this is the icon of application icon. So this, there are different icons available. So application level, if it is Node.js or Java or different types of application we want to deploy. So for that we can customize the icon and we can see the how the application is running. So when we click on here, so all the details will be provided here. So how it is running and how, what are the health checks of the application. So when you see the details, so still it is creating the namespace. We provided the project name. So it is taking, so how much percentage maximum utilization. There is an option called update strategy, rolling update. What are the labels? This is taken care by OpenShift, is providing the labels by taking the name of the application, and it's providing the labels as well as we can check the status here. So it is now active, it's running, now it's building. Now if you go here, resource level, so we can check the logs, how it's building. Now it is in running state. If you click on view logs, it is cloning the code from repository and creating an image with a Docker file. So itself, it's creating a Docker image and pushing into Docker registry, like long image registry. So it will take 5 to 5 minutes of time. So meanwhile, we'll discuss some other points, like here. We'll go to the administrator level. These are the image strings. This is the image creating. So we can access later, we can redeploy the application by using this image stream and whenever it is required. I want to deploy into the test environment. I want to deploy into dev environment. I want to deploy into the production environment. By using this, we can deploy. If you go for build, so it will see, we can see the logs, like, you know, how it is. It is in the running state now. So when we check these parts, so this deployment is done or not, we can see here. So when you go to the logs, it's still going on. It's still creating the image. And you check this pod section. So UI application is still running. And you check the logs, it will show so how the it is going on. So what are the AML file? So the AML file we will not need to create. So everything will be created here, like so what network should be taken. So this is in the predefined, like everything, which link should be provided. This is the AML file of creating the image. Creating the pods. So now it is in running state. Once it completes, the build is completed. So now it's completed. Now we'll check the pods. So the pod is created. If you click on the pod, so we can monitor, like, you know, by using this memory usage, how much usage is taken care, like, you know, how much CPU, how much file system, like, you know, if you provided this application is running in particular storage or particular path using, what is the percentage of using. We can check with this. And also it is providing with different tools like Grafana and Prometheus. We can monitor the application level and node level. So when you click on this, which port and the pod IP and which port it's providing. And these are the status of the application, status of the pod, we can see here. So all the details, how it is creating. So to access the application after creating, so we will go to network part. There is a service called service. So one service will be created. So this is the UI front-end application. Service is created with a particular IP, with a particular port. We provided 8080. This is the selector, pod selectors, how to access the application, the labels also created. So when you go to the routes here, by clicking this, we can access outside. Yeah. Application is deployed successfully and we can access outside. This is the front-end application. Same way we can create backend and we can integrate and we can access, we can check with, we can authenticate with multiple tools like, you know, KeyClock. The KeyClock is Red Hat flavor, like to authenticate from the login from front-end to the backend for user authentication. So for KeyClock, we no need to create like, you know, Postgres or other database. It will create automatically. So these are the major advantages to just one click providing the information of inputs and we'll access immediately. And we can redeploy if any changes required, we can redeploy the image and we can use this. This is the major advantage of the application deployment in OpenShift. So if I want to deploy any the predefined any applications, we have like, you know, operators. So when you click on operator, there are a lot of catalogs are available by using that catalog. So this is the playground. It's not, it's just creating, giving the information. When we set up an on-premises and cloud environment, it will redirect to that available catalogs, the KeyClock, or a different type of application, we can access it. So this is by using this GitHub repository, it is creating, like, now we can check this. So the, how the secrets are created for this, we can see. UI front-end application. We can check with the YAML files here. and if we require to change any secrets here, or do you want to secure that application with secrets or for encryption part. So we can do all this. We can modify and we can redeploy and we can save it. So we can access with the config maps. Everything will be created. This is the deployment of DDO application. And also I want to show here, in here. So for example, here in the terminal, we can access. So which user is created, or I want to log in with this particular user, developer. So I want to log in with developer. And again, I want to check which user is accessing. If I want to log in with the admin, so we can access with this from terminal. Little bit slow. Yeah. So by using the default project, so if I want to create a new project, so I want to see the project to access. So we will execute like this, my project. So this is a work, so single node cluster. So it is accessing only one node, one master node. So kubectl pods, you see. Okay, we will log in with it, our project, project walking tree. This is the front end of, this is the deployment happen. This is the container we created. So if anything failures or any troubleshoot we required, we can do with the terminal as well as UI. We can modify the application or YAML files as per the requirement, and we can redeploy. These are the major advantage, like how we created. So I want to show one more thing. So PVs. So these are the volumes, PVs. We can, it's created default creation. So if I want to access with this persistent volume to the persistent volume claim, we can change and we can bound that to the particular application and we can access with that. So if it is required for a MySQL database or PostgreSQL database, we can bound these volumes, PV persistent volumes to the particular database and we can access. So, and also there is another feature, like, you know, the policies. I want to give particular policies to the particular user. So here using any UID, like I want to create a particular specific user to provide particular permission or particular project, we will provide and will restrict that in the project level as well as application level to access to, like, you know, developer point of view. So multiple developers can access it with multiple projects. So this is a network isolation, like application isolation, we can say, as we see in the PPT. So same way, we can restrict this. That's it, my end. Any question? Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sudhir. We do have a question from Gopal on as to why should we opt for OpenShift only when we have several other alternatives?
Yeah, that's a good question, Gopal. There is a different between, like, you know, different open source tools like in the Kubernetes and OpenShift. Kubernetes have a particular restrictions. We cannot access in the UI level. If you want to set up in the UI level, there is an other process. Again, we need to, I want to communicate or I want to set up particular, access the applications. I want to health check of the pods, health check of the application. There is a different ways. In the Kubernetes level, we need to set up what is called Prometheus or Grafana. So those things. So when you come to this here, there is a monitoring. I will show you this. There is a monitoring part. The predefined structure will be provided. So all the metrics of this we can access. We can see here. No need to create again Alert Manager or Prometheus or different things. And we can check this. These are the major advantages. And also more secure. It's not an open source. We need to subscribe it to access this, as well as there is a more restrictions to deploy any application, outside application, or it will not allow like, you know, root user privileges, how it is doing in the Kubernetes level. These are the major differences and to containerized application.
Yeah, Sudhir, I would like to add a point here. Primarily that, let's say if someone is comparing between Kubernetes and OpenShift, when to go for OpenShift and when to go for Kubernetes. So OpenShift is a preferred choice in case you have a standard deployment process. That means your application is does not need any out-of-box solution. You can use a standard deployment process for your project. Then OpenShift is good because you do not need to spend a lot of time. You have all the predefined standard process in place. So the moment you'll be able to, if you're able to write a Docker file, you'll be able to deploy the application for yourself, okay? But Kubernetes will allow you to write a lot of customization so that you can tailor your containerization needs as per your project need, okay? So let's say if we have a choice of using these two, straightforward direct implementation, and I have a low skilled people, I'll just get one guy to get OpenShift set up, and rest of the development deployment can be managed by my team. That's where OpenShift. But I need a tailored a solution for my containerization, then Kubernetes is a choice.
Thank you, Suman. We have one more question from Raghu. What is the difference between Elastic Beanstalk and this OpenShift?
Elastic Beanstalk is a very early version of this containerization. Okay, and on top of that, Elastic Beanstalk, Elastic Container Service came in AWS, and Elastic Container Service got further. AWS started supporting EKS, Elastic Kubernetes Service, and the OpenShift is altogether a different tool, which is like OpenShift is having Kubernetes inside it, and it provides you a GUI so that you do not need to write a lot of manifest files.
All right, so I suppose these are the questions we have for you today. Sudhir, thank you once again, and thank you to you as well, Suman. Okay, I think, yes, we have a few more questions, I think. Will you be getting a recording of this? Of course, you will. Once we're done with the session, we will definitely be sharing the recording for this session with you. Just one last question. Can we handle service mesh in OpenShift?
We should be able to handle service mesh in OpenShift.
All right. Okay, fine. So that's all we have for you, everyone, today. Please do join us next week. We will be sharing details of the webinar with you on mail, as well as the recording of this one. Thank you once again.
Thank you all.
Thank you.